areas where there's critical investments across DHS and the multi-missions that we carry out. And I want to ensure this committee that we're not going to lose any momentum on our multiple missions, from cybersecurity to disaster response, as we see what's happening this morning with the floods in Oklahoma, the tornado that touched down in Missouri. We're going to stay on top of all of these mission sets, and I do want to highlight some of the investments there. And then, of course, I will speak to the border security crisis, which this committee is very focused on and understands very well. The President's budget requests funding for critical missions across the department. For our Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, the budget requests $1.3 billion to assess evolving cybersecurity risks, protect federal government information systems, and critical infrastructure. The budget also supports the launch of Project 2020, a new initiative designed to get all states to a baseline level of election infrastructure cybersecurity well before the national elections of 2020. The budget supports additional transportation security officers to enhance security effectiveness and stay ahead of increasing costs and growing traffic at airports nationwide. The $3.3 billion for TSA also includes funding for an additional 700 screeners and 350 computed tomography units. For FEMA, this budget provides a significant increase in the Disaster Relief Fund, begins implementation of new requirements in the Disaster Recovery Reform Act, and funds critical operational positions identified in the 2017 hurricane season after action report. And for the U.S. Coast Guard, this budget continues efforts to fund the offshore patrol cutter and advances a polar security cutter program. But with regard to border security and immigration enforcement, as you are well aware, we are in the midst of an ongoing security and humanitarian crisis at the southwest border. I think your chart puts that in stark context, stark relief, Mr. Chairman. Almost 110,000 migrants attempted to cross without legal status last month, the most in over a decade, and over 65%, as you highlight, were families and unaccompanied children. That means over 40,000 children entered our immigration system in a single month. The President's budget will help address this for 2020. First, it requests $523 million for the humanitarian crisis. This money will allow us to provide better care for those who we come into contact with through apprehension, custody, detention, and removal. Second, to address the border security aspects of the crisis, it requests $5 billion in funding for the construction of approximately 200 miles of new border wall system, a proven deterrent requested by our frontline agents, and it also calls for 750 Border Patrol agents, 273 CBP officers, and over 660 ICE frontline and support personnel. The budget request will make much-needed upgrades to sensors, command and control systems, and aircraft to help our men and women combat criminals who are profiting from human suffering. While our 2020 budget will help address this crisis, we will need additional funding much sooner. Given the scale of what we're facing, we'll exhaust our resources before the end of this fiscal year, which is why the administration sent a supplemental funding request to the Congress over 3 weeks ago. In addition to the $3 billion in that request for Health and Human Services to care for unaccompanied children, the request includes $1.1 billion for the Department of Homeland Security and would provide $391 million for humanitarian assistance, including temporary migrant processing facilities at the southwest border, $530 million for border operations to include our surge personnel expenses and increased transportation and detention costs, and $178 million for operations and support costs, including pay and retention incentives for our operational personnel, as well as upgrading our IT systems. The supplemental request is critical, but unless Congress addresses the pull factors, namely our vulnerable legal framework for immigration, children will continue to be put at risk during a dangerous journey to our border. Without these authorities and resources, the situation will remain untenable. And while DHS will continue to do all it can to manage this crisis in an operationally effective, humane, safe, and secure manner, every day that Congress does not act puts more lives at risk and increases the burden on the system. Mr. Chairman, Mr. Ranking Member, I've been doing this for a long time. This is the third time I've been in a leadership role during a migration surge at the border of families and children, both in 2014 and 2016 at the end of the last administration. We have more than doubled those two crises combined in the first 7 months of this year, and we are still in the middle of that effort. We're doing everything we can to address it, as you'll see as you go down to the border again today. On the medical front, you know, we had about 10 people providing medical care in our top central processing center as of a year ago. We now have 50 in that center alone. It's 24/7 coverage in all of our highest traffic sectors, and we're expanding. We have U.S. Coast Guard medical teams on the ground. We have Health and Human Services, Public Health Service, Commission Corps on the ground with us, working to protect especially children that come into our custody. We've expanded our facilities. We've already put up 1,000 spaces of soft-sided facilities in 2 locations. We're going to have 10,000 by the end of next month to address this growing crisis. We've gotten tremendous support from the Department of Defense, National Guard, from our state and local partners, and we're working closely with non-governmental organizations and charities to try to help those in need. But none of that is going to be enough. We are still seeing too much tragedy, and this week and this month have been no exception. 40% of our agents are off the line doing processing, transportation, care, hospital watch, and feeding and cleaning of migrants in our custody. This leads to significant border security risk that I don't think we can tolerate given the drug epidemic and the dangers to our communities across the country. On my second week in this job, I went to see the 9/11 Memorial Museum to get re-inspired at the origin of the Department of Homeland Security. And it was a good reminder that Homeland Security, when we started, was nonpartisan. It was a nonpartisan mission that all Americans supported. And I know this committee works in that spirit. Through your prior hearings to become expert on this and help inform the American people, for your efforts to go to the border, and I know you're going again, this is a unique approach this committee's taking to actually grapple with the problem based on a shared set of facts and solve it. I want to work with you and the ranking member and both parties. Our frontline agents and officers need it. They deserve that support from this committee. The children being put at risk do as well, and the security of our border and the future of our region depend on it. So I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you today, and I look forward to the dialogue this morning.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I'm happy to defer my questioning to you or to Senator Portman to just keep things moving. Did you want to ask your questions now?
Yeah.
Go ahead. Senator Peters.
Well, thank you, Acting Commissioner McLennan, for your comments. And I know you mentioned in your opening comments the challenges, the medical challenges in particular that you're having along the border. But last evening, it was reported that a young girl from El Salvador died last year while in custody, but her death was undisclosed publicly until last night, which made her the 6th migrant child to die after crossing the southern border in less than a year. Now, we all agree that we must absolutely secure our borders, but the death of children, and I know you agree with this, the death of children in custody is simply unacceptable. But first, we must identify what went wrong and ensure that this doesn't happen again. So some brief questions. Yes or no, does every child in CBP custody have access to a pediatrician?
No.
Does the CBP have clear protocols regarding the transfer of children to a hospital when presenting acute symptoms, especially when we look at the aggressive nature of this current flu outbreak that we're seeing along the border?
Yes, and as commissioner, I directed that all children coming into our custody be screened by a certified medical professional, and that's what we've undertaken steps to accomplish, both with our extension of our contract to get medical professionals into our facilities, as well as partnering with U.S. Coast Guard and the Public Health Service Commission Corps. And that effort is extensive and ongoing, with 65 people being brought to the hospital every day, watched and supported by agents and officers. So this is a massive effort going on the border to protect children, and I know we have saved dozens and dozens of lives over the past several months.
Although there's been cases, we had a recent case of a 16-year-old that passed away who was not taken to the hospital. So there are obviously gaps that have to be filled.
He was both screened and offered medical care, and we're going to look forward to the findings of the Inspector General to see if we could do better. One of the key areas there, though, I've got to highlight is the fact that HHS does not have enough funding for bed space for teenage males, and that's the main arriving unaccompanied child right now. So we are not able to move teenage males as expeditiously as we should be to the better situation for care within Health and Human Services, and we need that support from Congress in the supplemental.
I've asked many of your colleagues in prior DHS leadership, and I'll ask you again today, how long is too long to detain a child?
So detention for a child is for the safety of the child. That's the only reason to do it. We don't believe that children should be detained in Border Patrol stations very long at all. We'd like to move them as swiftly as possible to Health and Human Services, to a more appropriate setting for unaccompanied children, where they can be placed with an appropriate sponsor through HHS's processes. And I think that's the best approach. I'd like to get that to 24 hours to 48 hours and try to comply at all times with the standard in the Trafficking Victims Reauthorization Protection Act, which is 72 hours.
So I get the sense you're saying any time is really too long to detain a child, so you try to expedite
an unaccompanied child. The child arriving with a parent,
right.
I do believe we should be able to have in an appropriate setting with access to educational, recreational space, medical care, and in a courtroom where we can finish an immigration proceeding upon arrival at the border, as opposed to
as quickly as possible.
Not finishing that as quickly as possible. Yes, there's no desire to detain children in any capacity for very long at all.
It's been reported that DHS is requiring FEMA, CISA, TSA, and other components to contribute staff to various border security missions. Securing our northern and southern borders must be our top priority. We have a northern border in this country as well, two borders, and I'm concerned about the potential impact on readiness in my state of Michigan as well as other northern border states. So my time is short, but could you give me quickly a brief synopsis of the specific duties that these folks are being asked to do on the southern border, FEMA, CISA, TSA?
So as in any crisis, we do call on volunteers from across DHS to respond. Last year, or 17, during the crisis season, is Hurricane Harvey, Hurricane Irma, Hurricane Maria, we had up to 2,000 people deployed from across the department at any given time. Right now, we got about 250 volunteers that are deployed. And what I've asked all of our leaders to do is make a risk assessment and carefully decide who's available to come support this crisis. But they're doing all kinds of duties, from attorneys to commercial driver's license holders that are helping transport migrants to folks just simply helping with food service and care of people in our custody. So it's a variety of missions, and we're very fortunate to have volunteers that are willing to help out in a crisis.
Obviously, a shortage of personnel is an issue for you, and even before the recent increase in migrant traffic at the southern border, it was clear that CBP was not adequately staffed to secure our borders and facilitate the other mission, which is to move legitimate trade and travel at our ports of entry. The CBP workload staffing model, developed under your leadership as the CBP commissioner, identifies a shortfall of thousands of CBP officials. Again, this is even prior to the current situation. To help address this gap in personnel, Senator Cornyn and I have introduced some bipartisan legislation. Also, Senator Portman has joined as well to give clear authority and direction to hire much-needed CBP officers to the levels that were identified in the model that you put together. I'm especially concerned about critical personnel being moved from Michigan to the southern border, while Michigan continues to maintain two of the three busiest border crossings in the nation. So, Acting Secretary, will you commit to working with Congress to advance this legislation and close the hiring gaps that we currently have with CBP officers?
I will, Senator, and appreciate greatly your support to additional hiring of CBP officers. It's one of the most critical occupations, both for our security and for facilitating trade and travel. We've netted 2,000 CBP officers over the last 5 years with Congress's support, and this year we're expecting to net over 1,200 additional CBP officers. Our hiring is very successful for CBP officers now, based on a number of changes we've made, support from Congress, but I do think a model-based staffing strategy that accommodates growing traffic, growing security threats is an appropriate way to plan for the future, and I appreciate the legislative efforts to support that.
Great. Well, I appreciate your support in getting this legislation passed and signed into law to support your efforts. Mr. Chairman, I have a little remaining time, but I'll defer that so we make sure everybody has a chance to ask questions. We'll stick to our strict 7-minute timeline.
Absolutely. I'm going to use my 7 minutes in little quips, or little clips. We were talking a little bit about hiring rate. Is it true that we have greater hiring than attrition rate right now?
For CBP officers, it significantly exceeds attrition. For our Border Patrol agents, it's much closer, unfortunately, to attrition, although we're making progress recovering from the shutdown period.
I mean, that's good news. I am highly concerned with the current crisis, particularly until when you don't have the resources and you're requiring all these volunteers, that Border Patrol officers will start quitting. I'm highly concerned about the attrition rate. So have you seen any uptick at all in that in the recent crisis?
So our attrition is higher than I would like for Border Patrol agents. My first decision as acting secretary was to extend a 5% retention incentive to our agents, who I think deserve it and are working incredibly hard at the journeyman level. We need to continue to look at all ways to maintain our tremendous professional workforce, and I do think they need to see a light at the end of the tunnel from this kind of crisis. And working with Congress to solve it legislatively, I think, is our best approach to do that.
Well, again, I want to urge all my colleagues here to support the emergency supplemental. It's just critical that you get that funding, and not just for HHS, but the $1.1 billion that DHS is requesting on that as well. Senator Portman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Secretary, we appreciate you coming back again, and you're here at a time where there is, without question, a crisis at the border. It's humanitarian, it's a drug crisis, it's an immigration crisis. Just to put some numbers around it, if you could help us, just so people can understand what's going on. My sense is there are now over 100,000 people coming to the border. My sense is there's about a 75% increase compared to last year in the number of children who are showing up at the border, and about a 400% increase in the number of families coming to the border. So not only higher numbers, but more families with children. Is that accurate?
That's exactly correct.
So it's overwhelming. And we appreciate your service and the service of the men and women of CBP and the Border Patrol who are trying to deal with this issue, many of whom are being pulled off their normal jobs, as I understand it, to deal with the humanitarian crisis. Is that accurate?
That's very true. I mean, the processing and care of families and children is much more intensive, and to have 40% of our Border Patrol agents engaged just in that function, not on the line, not addressing the border security parts of their mission, is a crisis by any measure. And I know you've been committed, Senator, to countering the drug epidemic in our country, especially the synthetic opioid concerns. I'm very concerned we're missing drugs right now on that border due to this crisis.
We're seeing on the drug front is pretty scary because we have finally some progress on the opioid front. For the first time in 8 years, we've seen some decrease in overdose deaths. But what's happening in my state of Ohio and around the country is you see a lot more crystal meth coming in from Mexico. It's pure, it's powerful, it's inexpensive. Frankly, there aren't any more the meth labs in places like Ohio. Why? Because it's so darn inexpensive and so powerful to just buy the stuff from the cartels coming up from Mexico. So, heroin, fentanyl, cocaine, but now pure crystal meth. On that, since you raise it, what is the single most important thing that we could do today to stop the crystal meth from coming across the border?
So the FY19 budget does a tremendous amount for us in this regard, and we're going to deploy those resources. Non-intrusive inspection technology for the southern border going to be able to dramatically increase the percentage of vehicles that we scan. It's going to be the single best tool we have to stop the increase
so
in crystal meth.
It's a new technology that we have funded to be able to see if there's a truck coming through, for instance, through a non-invasive technology to be able to, essence, to see whether there are drugs there and then to be able to apprehend.
Right. Two additional points I would make, though, is the investments in the border wall and the system around that, the cameras, the lighting, the roads that allow us to gain access. Mm-hmm. That will help us address the increasing incidence of hard narcotics coming between ports of entry. Mm-hmm. And then third, resolving this crisis, our agents can be back focused on the border security aspects of their right. mission.
Not pulled off for the humanitarian.
Three things I would highlight.
Yeah. Let's talk about push and pull factors for a second, because ultimately what we're trying to do here in this committee is to help you to be able to address this issue. On the push side, we talk a lot about the Northern Triangle countries being countries where there's a lot of poverty and a lot of corruption and reasons for people to want to leave. So we've talked about how to get aid and have it be more effectively deployed in those countries. I think there's a general consensus among at least members of this committee that we should do a better job and can. However, we're still going to have huge wage differentials. There's still going to be issues in El Salvador, Honduras, Guatemala that cannot be addressed simply by aid packages. So what are the pull factors? It seems to me that the most important one right now, given this, again, 400% increase in families, 75% increase in kids, over 100,000 people a month now coming over that border, is there's something going on with the asylum system, because they're coming over to seek asylum. They're coming to your officers. They're not trying to avoid law enforcement. In fact, the wall probably is not helpful in this regard, in the sense that they aren't trying to climb over a wall. They're coming forward and saying that they would like to get asylum. Tell us what happens, if you could, to these families when they approach one of your officers and ask for asylum. Are these individuals being processed? Are they being detained? Are they being allowed to go into the community? What's happening today?
Yeah, so you're absolutely right, Senator, on the poll factors. And I would actually use your committee's chart on this point, because you see in FY15 there, Flores reinterpreted. That's been the essential driver, frankly, for the increased family units, is the fact that family units can no longer be detained together in an appropriate setting during a fair and expeditious proceeding to determine whether they have a valid asylum claim or other immigration rights.
Family members of their children there are limited to 20 days, and that's in an emergency, and otherwise they have to be released into the community. Is that accurate?
That's correct. And that certainty and knowledge that they'll be allowed to stay in the U.S. indefinitely, pending a court proceeding that could be years away depending on what jurisdiction they're in, is a huge draw. The smugglers have capitalized on that. They're advertising that fact. We hear that routinely from our interviews of families. We see that in the media.
What percent of those families who come up to the border and, again, approach your officer, ask for asylum, are being released into the community within days?
No, 100%.
100%.
Yeah, and they're not necessarily asking for asylum. They don't have to. They can go into an immigration proceeding and not have to present that case for
potentially
years.
And when they go into the community, you say it can take a while. It's over 2 years in Ohio, you should know, before we can have a court hearing.
So right.
It's over a two-year period. What's the average around the country, do you know?
The average is around 2 years. In some jurisdictions, it's even longer.
2 years before the immigration hearing takes place.
Right.
And during that time period, can those individuals work?
Yes, by and large, although we're looking at tightening the rules so that there's not an opportunity to take advantage of the system.
So they have a work permit. My understanding is they don't get the work permit immediately, but after a certain period of time, is it 6 weeks?
It's right now, it's in the 30 to 90 days range. That's correct.
Mm-hmm. And those individuals then are going to work. So if you're a trafficker, what you're telling people is, one, if you come to the border and seek asylum, or even if you're coming to the border and seeking an immigration hearing, you'll be released into the community for a couple of years at least before your hearing, and you'll have the ability to work. And with a wage differential, being able to make 10 times as much or sometimes as much as 20 times as much in the United States, do you think that is a factor?
I think that not only is it a factor, that is directly how smugglers are advertising the opportunity to come to the U.S. right now.
So ultimately, it comes down to the jobs.
Right.
We want to talk more about E-Verify at some point, because we don't have a system now to determine who's legal and who's not in our country, and we need to increase the mandatory use of E-Verify. But thank you, Mr. Commissioner. Now, Mr. Secretary.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Portman. Again, there's a great deal of interest in this hearing. We'll have a lot of attendance, so we allowed 7 minutes, but we're going to keep people right at 7 minutes. So, Senator Hassan.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair and Ranking Member Peters, and thank you, Acting Secretary McAleenan, for being here to discuss all these important topics. Mr. Secretary, as I'm sure you are aware, convicted American Taliban fighter John Walker Lind is reportedly being released from federal prison today. Last week, Senator Shelby and I sent a letter to the Bureau of Prisons expressing concern over the anticipated release of John Walker Lind, as well as 108 other terrorist offenders scheduled to be released in the next 5 years. One of our concerns is the lack of adequate process to notify federal, state, and local officials when a terrorist offender will be released. Mr. McAleenan, do DHS fusion centers receive information from the Bureau of Prisons or Probation and Pretrial Services regarding the release of a terrorist offender? And what's your process for sharing this information with local authorities?
That's a good question, Senator. I'll look into that and get back to you on that.
Okay, so moving forward, can I count on you to work with relevant agencies to develop a strategy to ensure that all necessary federal, state, and local officials have the information that they need to keep communities safe when these individuals are released?
Yes.
Thank you. Later today, I'm headed to the southern border with Chairman Johnson and Ranking Member Peters and Senator Hawley to assess the situation on the ground. I took a similar trip last year to talk to port officers and ICE detention officers. I was impressed by my visits to El Paso and McAllen, Texas, where I saw the robust screening effort conducted by CBP of incoming traffic from Mexico. And we talked a little bit just now about some of the technology that helps officers kind of immediately see what's different in a car that the surface looks like a typical car. However, stopping the drug cartels is not solely a matter of securing traffic coming into the United States. We have to attack the cartel's business model. That means stopping the flow of both drug money and weapons that travel southbound into Mexico from the United States. Unfortunately, as I saw on my trip last year, our current southbound screening effort is inadequate. We were told we need expanded facilities, more personnel, and updated technology in order to try to strengthen our ability to stop the flow of guns and money back into the cartel's hands. So, Mr. McAleenan, I will ask you the same question that I asked Secretary Nielsen last year. Are you satisfied with the current state of southbound inspections?
No, I agree strongly with you that we can do more. And part of the non-intrusive inspection equipment that we're going to be purchasing with the FY19 funding will go to outbound lanes. But to your point, we've been doing outbound alongside our Border Patrol agents and CBP officers jointly. We don't have agents available to do outbound right now. They're doing the inbound humanitarian mission. So we also can improve our efforts in coordination with the government of Mexico. So I think there's a lot to do in that area, and we can get stronger.
Okay. Do you given the numbers and the humanitarian crisis that we're seeing now, I'm taking that you wouldn't say we've made real progress on this issue since last year on southbound?
The one area we're making progress is in acquiring the systems that will help us screen more vehicles going southbound and more K-9 teams.
Okay.
But and in our overall hiring of CBP officers that will strengthen our base on the southwest border. But no, with our agents now redeployed on humanitarian missions, with a new government coming in and establishing new relationships on the investigative side, I think we can do a lot more this year.
Okay. And so one of the other things I heard last year was that it may take some work and planning with local authorities on both the north and south side of the border to configure things in a way that allows those inspections to take place without interfering with local traffic and the like. Is that something that you guys have been addressing?
Absolutely. No, every port of entry has plans for how to do outbound inspections, given their unique flow of traffic, given the unique configuration of the footprints of ports of entry, which, again, have been there for a long time and were designed at a much lower volume of flow, both north and southbound. So, yes, that we have plans locally for increased outbound efforts.
Well, I would look forward to working with you on that, and I'll take this as a commitment to continue to work on that, because I really think till we get to the southbound flow, we're not going to break up these business models.
Important aspect of the mission, I agree.
Okay. Mr. McAleenan, back in March, I requested from Secretary Nielsen the case files for the reported 245 child separations that had occurred since a federal judge ruled that these separations must end. Understanding the need for privacy and confidentiality, I would have accepted redacted names and addresses. A week after my request, a representative from CBP followed up to say that you, as commissioner of CBP, could brief me on this matter, but not until 7 weeks after my initial request. We responded with dates and times that worked, but heard nothing back from your office until just 2 days ago, 10 weeks after my request, when your office replied to say that you could not provide specific information on these 245 cases. I'll also note that just this week, reports surfaced that, as we've talked about, 16-year-old Carlos Vasquez has died in federal custody at the border, the fifth child to die, and just last night, as Senator Peters pointed out, we learned about a sixth child's death. After apprehension by border agents. This is incredibly disturbing and raises more serious questions about the treatment of children at the border. I know you care about it, but we obviously have to be able to implement real plans here to prevent these kinds of tragedies from happening. Can you provide any update on the cases of these 245 separated children for us, or about what CBP is doing to provide more accountability for the treatment of children at the border?
So first of all, I'll go back and look at your oversight request and make sure we're responding appropriately and timely.
Thank you
for raising. I was not aware that we had been delayed in that response. Secondly, I just want to emphasize that any separation that's occurring now is occurring for the benefit of the safety of the child. This is in compliance with the court order in Ms. L. It's compliance with the executive order from the president from June 20th of last year. So we're seeing that even though we have 1,500 to 2,500, some days over 3,000 families, a separation's only occurring one to three times a day.
And
so it's extraordinarily rare and under very controlled circumstances.
So I thank you for that answer. And because I'm running out of time, I want to be respectful of the time here. But I want to say that this is not all necessarily on you and your agents, but this administration has given a variety of stories about family separation since they even officially began. So you can understand that from an oversight point of view, in order to protect children. We need this information, and we need to engage with you to ensure that what your intentions are, what you're saying to me now, is actually what's happening. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Senator Paul.
Thank you for your testimony. I think it is important that we know who comes to our country, who's visiting, you know, on student visas. If we have intelligence that they're, you know, here with bad intentions, we don't let them in. If they aren't going to school, they are sent back home. But we have a problem that seems to be recurring with one of our universities. Campbellsville University has been around for 113 years. I've been there many times. It's a great college. It's a real college with a great reputation in our state. They've had three students recently come in on student visas that were either had their visas taken away or returned back. I don't think it's because of there was any kind of actionable intelligence or that the kids did anything wrong or the university did anything wrong, but the Border Patrol agents are simply saying it's a fake university, which one is very insulting to our university and to our state. But I think it's not just the border agent problem. It must be some kind of central list. Wouldn't you think they have to type into a list for a student visa and say what universities are on that list? The university is on the list of approved students. The only anomaly may be that it's an online course. So some of the students are coming into other airports, so they're coming into Los Angeles, and they do part of the course in Kentucky and part of it online. But it's approved by ICE. It's approved by the government. But the problem is your officers, either it's not typed into the system correctly or whatever, but then they're insulting these students, turning them back, and insulting the university also. We sent a letter to you 63 days ago, and I think there's been some response, and I think some attempt to resolve this, but 10 days ago, another student was turned back. And look, I'm all for safety. I'm all for not letting people come in here who are problems, but it doesn't sound like there was an individual problem here. There's more a systemic problem that you just don't have your list right, or your agents don't have access to the list. Do you know how it works? Does an agent type in a list to come up with the university when a student comes in from abroad?
Thank you, Senator. I do know how the student visa program works. It's managed by ICE. You have to have, first of all, a certified program, certified university, and then the individual student visa holder has to be confirmed to be part of that certified program.
I think all that's
program.
True, and they're still coming up and insulting our university and saying it's fake, and we've got no evidence, and no one's presented any evidence that they're not on the appropriate list.
Sure.
So.
I'm not familiar with the individual case, but we'll certainly look into it, and I'm glad you've gotten some response toward resolving it, but we'll take
right.
a look.
We need more, and the sooner the better, because it's a big deal for someone to fly halfway around the world to go to school here and be, one, insulted, the university's insulted, and we need some resolution, but
yes.
You'll try to help us with getting resolution. We have somebody call us within a week or so and try to work through this so we don't have a recurrence.
Yeah, we'll follow up.
Okay. The other issue I have is one we had with the last nominee for ICE. We weren't too fond of him because of one of his statements. One of his statements was that a cell phone is just like a shipping container. And not only do we object to that, we object strenuously to that. We're insulted by the comment. Do you think a cell phone is the same as a shipping container?
So all goods that cross the border are subject to examination, but actually we have specific policy for cell phones. It is different. They have a different level of data that they can contain, and that's why we have restrictive approaches to whether we can inspect it and how we inspect it.
All right. We want you to be even more restrictive. We want the law changed. So Senator Wyden and I actually have a bill to require a warrant for U.S. citizens coming back home, because we think there's a great danger that if you have brown skin or a different accent or a funny last name that doesn't look so-called American, that you're going to get, all of a sudden they're going to say, give us your cell phone. And that's, you know, if you have evidence someone's calling a terrorist, you have someone that they're part of a terrorist cell, by all means, stop them, keep them, do whatever it takes. But just random American citizens coming home being asked for their password to the cell phone, we think is very intrusive without any kind of other one. We just think they look suspicious. That's not enough. And so we're still troubled by the reports we hear on this, and we're going to keep pushing the issue. But it's very important for us to convey to you that we don't think a cell phone is a shipping container. You do have the right to go through luggage and shipping containers at the border. You don't really have a right to look at my Google searches and to look at my everything I've got stored on my phone, pictures, et cetera, and down that to a computer. When you're taking phones and you're getting passwords, are you downloading contents from the phone to a database?
So there are a couple different types of searches. A basic search where you would just look at the surface content of the cell phone, and then more in-depth search of a phone or in the contents. It will require reasonable suspicion, supervisory approval, and several additional safeguards. Senator, I know your concerns are sincere and well-informed on this issue. I do want to emphasize, though, that we have oversight over the selection for secondary and the selection for secondary that includes an inspection of a cell phone device. And any indication that would be done on the basis of race, religion, or anything else would be unacceptable. And it's overseen not only by CBP's Office of Professional Responsibility, but by our Civil Rights and Civil Liberties Office.
You can see how the danger occurs, though, because a lot of it is ambiguous when you go to what is suspicion. And so you can see how there's a real danger, and for people coming back to be targeted based on it, even if it's not spoken, you know, that there's a danger that there's a bias in the way this is happening. And so the regulations you have on the phone on what you do to go to a phone search, are those printed and open and available to us?
Yes, we published a policy online, and I personally worked on the update and the more stringent requirements in the policy.
Okay. And I know you deal from your perspective. From our perspective, there are many of us who think there actually should be a legal requirement for a judicial search, that this is not the same as looking at the luggage. And so just at least realize that there are some of us that are very concerned about this, the invasiveness of this search. Thanks.
Senator Carper.
Thanks, and thanks very much for visiting with us yesterday, Mr. Secretary, and sharing your thoughts and ideas with us. I'm going to ask you to use most of my 7 minutes to just to sketch for us an outline of that includes push and pull factors, includes Alliance for Prosperity, includes in-country asylum, includes changes in the way we process people at the border, immigration judges, and so on. Just take my 7 minutes and just put together a thoughtful, compassionate, smart, cost-effective plan. I think the smartest thing we could do would be actually do comprehensive immigration reform, and God willing, someday we'll get back and do that. That's probably the ultimate answer. But just take the next six and a half minutes to do that for me, please.
Thank you, Senator, for that opportunity. And I think at the start of the hearing, the chairman's opening statement, some of our discussions on the Flores case and the increased arrival of families and children over the last several years, I think we talked a lot about the pull factors and the direct response to the fact that families can no longer be held together through an appropriate and fair proceeding and have essentially a guarantee of release and an indefinite stay in the United States. That's a tremendous challenge. It's been exploited by smugglers who are advertising that opportunity, and that's what's causing the significant surge that we see this year. Unaccompanied children as well, even if they don't have a valid asylum claim from Central America, are also not able to be repatriated under the Trafficking Victims Protection Reauthorization Act. Those are the two key factors we're facing. And then the third is on the pull factor side, is the asylum gap. The fact that the credible fear standard is a possibility of proving an asylum case, that means that 87% to 92% of those who have that initial credible fear screening are passing it. But they don't actually see a judge for an asylum process for 2 to 5 years later. And when they go through an asylum process, we're only seeing 10 to 15% granted asylum. So those are the three areas that are huge vulnerabilities in our legal framework that we've asked Congress to tighten down. We've sent language to the Hill multiple times. There's some good legislative work going on right now in the Judiciary Committee with Chairman Graham's bill, but we need to partner on that. That would address the pull factors quickly and immediately. The President highlighted Senator Graham's bill as an immediate approach to the crisis in his Rose Garden remarks on a broader approach to immigration reform last week. On the push factors, they're significant and challenging. I've been to Central America three times. I'll be going in the last year. I'll be going on Monday to meet with my minister counterparts in Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador in Guatemala City. I'll be going back to the Western Highlands in Guatemala, which is really the source of most of the migration that we're seeing from Guatemala. It's about 40% of the total arriving at the border right now is from a specific region of Guatemala. I'm going to one department where over 3.5% of that population has come to the U.S. in 7 months. And that's because they're facing poverty and economic opportunity gaps. The average age in Guatemala is 19. The People entering the job market are almost 200,000 a year, while they're only creating 40,000 jobs. So there's a huge economic driver and a huge opportunity gap. Senator Portman highlighted the wage differential as well. If you can make 15 to 20 times what you can make at home in a booming economy in the U.S., and you have a guaranteed ability to stay indefinitely, that's a massive draw and incentive. The second thing is there's been drought in this region for the last 5 years. That's affected the subsistence farming in the Western Highlands and the rural areas of Guatemala and Honduras as well. This is their crop cycle, corn, beans, and potatoes every year. The beans are not producing. That's their source of protein. That's a big issue. It's one that USDA and USAID have tried to help with, preparing crops that are drought resistant. But that's been a massive impact. And then the global coffee price has cratered that affected the employment in Guatemala as well. So they're big economic drivers. On the security side, the situation is actually improving in all three countries. The murder rate has gone down significantly, 40 to 70%, depending on each country and the municipal areas. The strategy in El Salvador for a consolidated whole of government effort at the municipal level is working. They are reducing violence and creating additional economic opportunity. But there's so much more to be done. The governance issues, the corruption issues definitely cause and produce push factors that are part of this crisis. So we need a strategy that effectively tackles both. We need help from Congress to address the pull factors. We need the border security investments that we're making to increase our capacity on the U.S. border. We need to partner with Mexico to tackle the transnational criminal organizations that are exploiting vulnerable migrants. And we need to engage the governments of Central America, working with accountable partners on targeted programs that make an impact in our national interest. So we've got a lot to do, but I think we have a coherent strategy. We have a plan, but we need Congress's support to implement it, both on the resources and the authority side.
What role do ambassadors play in those three countries?
So I think our professional diplomats, led by two great ambassadors and the Chargé d'Affaires, Heidi Fulton in Honduras, are leading staffs that are well informed about the situations in those three countries. There are professional diplomats in USAID that are really driving some of the program successes that we're seeing, especially in El Salvador. I've had the benefit of going to see them at work and see how hard they're working in partnership. And I do think we've got a great dedicated diplomatic corps that's trying to advocate for change and improvements in conditions in all three countries.
How do you say to my colleagues, there's not been a U.S. ambassador in Honduras for over 2 years. That's shameful. And we've got to be smarter than that. And the role that they play, the role that Gene Mains played, ambassador to Salvador, and following the election of a guy named Bukele, who's a new president-elect for El Salvador, and helping him prepare to assume office and put together his team, hugely helpful role, hugely constructive role. And the fact that we've been almost 2.5 years without ambassador in Honduras is just something that we ought to just raise our voices and say, we can do better than this. Real quick, tell us two or three areas where we can help you in terms of filling vacancies around you where you have a lot of acting people in place.
So we have several nominees in front of the committee. I think getting an inspector general for oversight is critical, and he's advanced through the committee. Thank you for that. We've got a FEMA nominee, and we're heading into hurricane season next week. I very much appreciate if we could schedule a hearing and move a tremendous nominee, Jeff Byard, through the process. Our chief financial officer, obviously another critical role. So there are some nominees that we've sent up to the Senate and more, hopefully, that we'll be able to produce in short order. But having the right leaders in the right positions is very important to maintaining our momentum.
Good. Thanks so much.
So now that I have a few more senators, I do want to draw your attention again to the cup where we've put our chart on, so hopefully people won't crumple up and throw it away. But the point I wanted to make is just in the first 3 weeks of May, 65,000 additional people have been added to that bar. My guess is this bar will show over or close to 400,000 in the first 8 months compared to 120,000 in all of the year 2014. So 400,000 is where we probably end up the month of May. So this is a growing crisis, and we have to support the Secretary. We have to pass that emergency spending bill. Senator Hawley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to start by talking about the disaster, the tornadoes that touched down in my state last night, causing very significant damage. We've lost, I'm afraid, three lives in southwest Missouri, also causing very significant damage in the middle of the state. We're still assessing the extent of the damage, and I'll be seeing it for myself very soon. I understand FEMA dispatched a search and rescue team. Thank you for that. I'm wondering if you can speak to what more FEMA might be prepared to do to help.
Yeah, I reached out to our acting administrator, Pete Gaynor, this morning on these issues. FEMA is on top of it. You noted the search and rescue team, very concerned, and please let me acknowledge the loss of life. FEMA will be there. We'll respond in support of your state and local authorities to address any damage from the storm.
Great. Thank you very much, and look forward to working with you on that. As you know, we're also in the midst of a major flood event in the state of Missouri, and Missourians are tough. I mean, there's nobody tougher. But we are going to need federal assistance to help rebuild those communities, those farms, and those towns, and I look forward to working with you on that as well. Let me ask you about another major problem in my state, which is the epidemic of drugs flowing into the state. I noticed in your written testimony that the words illegal drugs appeared just once, which I was a little bit surprised by. So let me give you a chance to elaborate here. The drugs coming across the southern border are making our way, I know, into cities across the country, but Missouri is very hard hit, and we have an epidemic of meth, our law enforcement agents will tell you. Most Missourians probably don't realize that the meth that is flooding into Missouri now isn't produced in the state anymore. It comes across that southern border. Talk to us about the drug crisis that we are facing at the border and that is affecting my state and I suspect all of the states of those of us sitting here.
Yeah, the drug crisis is both acute and devastating. We had a colloquy with Senator Portman about both opioids and the increasing meth. If you talked with sheriffs and state and local police over the last 2 years west of the Mississippi, they would have been talking about meth, not the opioid or synthetic opioid crisis. Now you're seeing meth expand east of the Mississippi as well. This is devastating, and it's our responsibility at DHS to do better with this challenge. As you noted, 90-plus percent of both heroin and meth are coming from Mexico now. The Mexican cartels have made it into a super lab science, and we are working with the Mexican authorities to try to take out some of these labs in key areas that we've helped them identify. But we need to do more at that immediate border as well. The investments from FY19 in increased non-intrusive inspection technology are going to be a game changer for us. Right now, about 85% of our seizures come from x-rays of personally owned vehicles. We're only getting to 2% of those cars right now. With the investments we got last year, we're going to be able to get up to 40%. And that's going to completely change our dynamic in terms of risk-assessed targeted inspections. For commercial vehicles, we're at 17%. We're going to be able to take that up over 70% in a matter of 2.5 years. That's going to be a very different target for the smugglers to try to get through. We're also increasing our canine teams, which are the second highest referral rate for our drug seizures. I do want to emphasize, though, that between the ports investments are also critical. The border barrier, the wall system with lights, cameras, sensors on top of that.
Tell us why that's so. Why is that so important?
Because we're seeing increasingly smugglers using between ports methods to bring in hard narcotics. That was not a significant phenomenon 5 years ago. It is growing now, and it's a huge challenge. In Rio Grande Valley, where we have the epicenter of the humanitarian crisis that we're talking about, last month we made a seizure of 750 pounds of cocaine in one seizure. They felt confident enough to bring that many drugs across, and we had one Border Patrol agent who laid in the brush for a week straight because he was worried about that stretch of border. He knew that they were using families to divert resources, so he laid in that stretch of brush and caught that load. I called him and talked to him about how dedicated he was to sit there for a shift and a half, 7 days in a row before he finally got that load. We know what's happening. We know they're using families to divert our resources and bring drugs behind them, and the border wall changes that dynamic.
What other resources do our agents need to combat this drug smuggling epidemic?
So we need better aviation surveillance. We've asked for surveillance sensors in the 2020 budget that will help our aviation platforms target crossings. We need the innovative towers that we're putting in place. We've received support from Congress 3 years in a row for innovative cost-effective programs on emerging technologies that are going to expand our surveillance capability. We need to finish our fixed tower deployment. That surveillance technology and the ability of our agents to respond effectively in a mobile way is a huge factor in our success.
Can I just ask you, how is the growing crisis of the asylum crisis and the illegal immigration crisis that we're seeing that the chairman's been talking about earlier today, how is that affecting your ability to combat the drug smuggling crisis as well?
So the first time I publicly referred to this as a border security and humanitarian crisis was last June, when we had one-fourth of the traffic we have now. So the humanitarian crisis is drawing away our Border Patrol agents. 40% of their time now is spent on transportation, processing, care, hospital watch, medical, food preparation for migrants. They're not on the line where we need them. In parts of El Paso sector, we are depleted 60-70% from what we'd like to be in our forward deployments on the line. That dynamic has to change. We need our agents back doing what the American people want them to do, protecting them on the border.
Well, is it fair to say that this Congress's inability to deal with the immigration and asylum crisis is helping fuel the drug epidemic crisis?
They're directly related.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. How frequently is Border Patrol apprehending members of transnational criminal gangs like MS-13?
So last year we apprehended 17,000 people with criminal records. We're going to exceed that significantly this year. We had 808 gang members in 18, where you have more so far coming this year. So there is a population. It's not just families and children. They are the bulk of who's crossing now. They present unique challenges, but we're talking about 35% of that traffic are people trying to evade capture, and hidden within that 35% are criminals, gang members, and drug smugglers. So we've got to address this comprehensively.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Scott.
Thanks for what you do. I was just down in Panama and met with some DHS representatives to talk about narco trafficking and the violence, and that's part of it. And I met with DEA, DOD, and they were talking about if they had some additional resources, the countries just north of there where a lot of the narco trafficking is coming out of, they could do a lot, and they thought that would have a positive impact on dealing with what's happening on our border. What do you need, and what can we do? What can Congress do to be more helpful in that arena?
Thanks, Senator, and thanks for visiting with our people. And I think one of DHS's strengths is our ability to support and work with foreign partners to make an impact on our security as far away from our border as possible, and really building their capacity, sharing information, and trying to make an impact together. And I think Panama is one of our best examples of that. Both the ICE and Homeland Security Investigation presence, as well as the CBP, the U.S. Coast Guard partnerships with Panama, I think are really a good example for the entire hemisphere. And we've made a lot of progress in the last 5 to 7 years, specifically with the government of Panama. You talk about the trafficking challenges in that region. The Andes are the highest cocaine producing rate. We still see lots of cocaine coming to our border. Actually, the numbers have been increasing the last 3 years. And addressing that at the source, with U.S. Coast Guard on the water, with Maritime Patrol, aircraft in the air, is really our best defense. And those interdictions are often driven by good intelligence sharing, by investigative efforts with HSI, DEA, and our intelligence community partners, working with the Colombian government, Panamanian government, and others to try to get those interdictions before they get out on the open water and land somewhere in Central America or Mexico and end up trying to come across our land border. So those partnerships forward deployed are critical. The investments in the Coast Guard fleet, I would highlight, are absolutely essential to helping us sustain a presence on the water there in the source and transit zones. And then our P3 fleet for CBP, our UAS fleet, the Guardians that are the Maritime Patrol version of our Predator drones, those are MQ-9s they're called. Those are critical assets, and we appreciate Congress's continued support for that.
They also talked about the fact that I guess it must have been from they're coming further south from South America. They're getting out further into the Pacific and then coming in, and there was possibly a need for additional, I don't know if it's DOD or Coast Guard assets. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, so we're seeing routes going around the Galapagos and then coming north. You know, from Baja California, we're seeing routes going out west of Catalina and coming up to the middle of California. So open ocean, you know, maritime patrol capability, whether it's emerging technologies with microsatellites, whether it's unmanned maritime drones, we need to look at opportunities to innovate in this space because we are seeing incredible efforts by cartels to avoid our current patrol efforts. So not only investments in what we're already doing conventionally, but we need to look out over the horizon and see what else, kind of what technologies we need to get better at this challenge. I agree with both.
The Comptroller General was just in, I guess, this week, talking about they review how agencies contract, and they're talking about FEMA to a certain extent. And I had every plague there was when I was governor of Florida. I had health and hurricanes and everything. What opportunities do you have, whether it's through FEMA or through anything else DHS is doing, that you can save money, that you could allocate more dollars to the issues we're dealing with on the border?
So that's actually a good question. I mean, at CBP, it was an area we worked very diligently on. Our procurement and acquisition staff, we reorganized them 2 years ago, and they've been very effective at getting good value for government, lowering our protest rate, ensuring we're using small and disadvantaged businesses. I think that's actually the story of DHS-wide. We've got a tremendous chief procurement officer in Soraya Correa, who oversees this effort. And I looked at the FEMA numbers. You know, we're looking at thousands of contracts that FEMA has issued in response to storms in your state and others that have been devastating over the past several years, and only four or five of them have had issues where they needed to be canceled. So I think the record is actually pretty good. I know there's been some high-profile concerns, but that's something I'll look at as acting secretary and make sure we're getting best value, saving money for the American taxpayer, and applying it to our mission priorities.
Yeah. From my standpoint, first off, FEMA has been a great partner. They really did a great job. And I had floods, everything you can imagine. They really were a really good partner. But I think there's a lot of money to be saved with, in one contract in particular, how they do debris, which is not done. I think FEMA pays for it, but it's done through the Corps. But the prices that the Corps contracted for the same company was multiples of what that same company would do business in Florida for. Hmm. It was not a little bit. It went from $7 to $8 a cubic yard to $72. So, I mean, it was a lot of money. So anything that we can do that can be helpful to you to save money there, that you might have money to allocate to things that are a bigger problem, I'd like to work with you on.
We'll commit to that. Right. Thank you, Senator.
Thanks. Senator Romney.
Thank you. Very much appreciate your testimony today and this opportunity to talk about your budget as well as policies relating to our border. Just a comment at the outset, which is it is hard for me to understand why border security has become such a partisan issue. And I think that there are people who have politicized it much to the peril of those who are doing so. I do understand that there are political issues associated with how we're going to deal with our DACA individuals, how we're going to deal with the 11 or 12 million or so of people who've come here illegally in the past and have been here for some period of time and raised their families here. People are concerned about whether we're going to have a system of legal immigration based upon joining families back together, family reunification versus a merit-based system. These all have, I think, understandable political back and forth. But securing the border and keeping people from flooding over the border illegally is something which I would think one could take out of the realm of politics. And I think those that are making this a political issue, I think it's a real loser, by the way, from a political standpoint, in part because without a completed wall, without the technology that we can avail ourselves of, we're going to see more and more drugs come into the country with people dying as a result of those drugs coming in. We're going to have a flood of children coming that get separated from parents and go off into foster settings in many cases, unaccompanied children, that is. It's just a a series of horrible potential outcomes or horrible reality that is occurring. I hope we're able to deal with the loopholes and gaps in our legal system that has caused this to a great degree this extraordinary crisis to occur. But with that said, let me turn to a question I'd just like to ask you. You've spoken about the importance of the wall, using better technology to interdict our Coast Guard as well in the open seas, closing the loopholes. And you mentioned that a number of people in Central America, and Mexico for that matter, look across the border and say, all right, I can get $15 an hour up there and I'm getting $1 an hour down here, and they're going to find a way, one way or the other. They're going to find a way to get here because of that enormous economic advantage in doing so. Some of us feel that we really should mandate a requirement that businesses use E-Verify, and that if a business does not use E-Verify, and if they are found to hire someone who's not here legally, that the business should be heavily sanctioned and fined, penalties, whatever, for not having used the E-Verify system. Do you believe that mandating E-Verify use with penalties would help and reduce the magnet, if you will, that brings people who just want to come here for economic opportunity?
Thank you, Senator. Just specifically on your E-Verify question, we support comprehensive use of E-Verify. Every employer should avail themselves of this opportunity. We just finished a development project to make it available for any employer, all 50 states, who wants to sign on. It's a robust IT system, and it provides quick responses on people at lawful status in the United States. And that employment magnet that you referenced, Senator, the booming U.S. economy, I should have included that in my response to Senator Carper as one of the huge pull factors. It's the opportunity we have right now in the U.S. And E-Verify is a tool to help make sure that that's done in a lawful manner. If I could add just one other point to your opening, I did close my oral statement with a request and an ask and an acknowledgement of this committee's ability to work in a bipartisan way, in a problem-solving way, and how welcome that is. I started after 9/11. Having border security be a politicized issue is new, and I don't think it's acceptable to the American people. So I applaud your call for taking that out of the dynamic, and let's look at the problem, and let's grapple with it and try to come up with shared solutions. So thank you.
Thank you. And now to a couple of topics that relate to the numbers, as this is a budget discussion as well,
right.
Or primarily an enormous increase in the budget request for FEMA. Looking at the president's request in 19 and 20, and then comparing that with what was enacted at 18, it's up some 40%+. Why is there such a substantial increase there?
I think the bulk of that is to get the disaster recovery fund to the level it needs to be to both address the past storms in 17 and 18, but have it prepared for the future. And it's a scalable drawdown. It doesn't have to stay obligated if we don't need to use it.
In a similar vein, there's an enormous increase in ICE from $7.5 million enacted in 2018 to $9.3 million requested in 2020. Why the substantial increase there?
Sure. I think there's two main issues. One, we need a lot more professionals at ICE. We've asked for 1,660 additional Homeland Security investigation agents, ICE enforcement removal officers, and support personnel and attorneys. Right now, our enforcement removal operations are sized for 34,000 people in custody, but they're holding 51,000. That means it takes longer to get each case processed, to get removals occurring, and they don't have the strength to do all of their missions at the same time. They're also fully involved in the border crisis. We've got hundreds of agents surged to the border dealing with child smuggling issues. They've come up in the first 3 weeks of that operation with 160 prosecutions for adults who are smuggling children across and posing as family units. We need more capability to do that work. So that's first, is the personnel. And second, on the ICE side, is just investing in our systems, our attorneys to get through the court proceedings, and a broad variety of requirements we have, and really just fund the bed space, the increased detention requirements from an increased flow across the border.
You indicated also, in response to another question from one of my colleagues, that the important role that the Coast Guard is playing in interdicting drug trafficking that's bringing ships, in some cases, north of Catalina Island. And yet the Coast Guard budget request is down pretty substantially from what was spent in 2018. Why the reduction in spending or funding for the Coast Guard?
So I think the main difference there, and I've talked to Commandant Schultz about whether he's getting the resources he needs to keep his capital investments moving forward. I think the big difference is the one-time initial startup cost for buying the icebreaker for the Arctic. That is not required in the 20 budget. We're going to sustain that program, but we don't need that first investment. So I think that's the big difference in the 19 and 20 budgets.
Thank you. My time is up.
Senator Langford.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much. We have a lot to cover, as you've seen, and we've gone through quite a bit. Let me go back to a couple of issues that we've already started to address a little bit. One is on the drug interdiction issues. And what I want to do is to be able to walk through the drug interdiction and what we're seeing coming from Mexico versus coming from China. One is obviously coming by mail more, and sometimes Chinese are sending it to Mexico, then Mexico's actually bringing it north from there. So help us understand what you see as the difference between the amount of drugs coming into the United States from Mexico and the amount of drugs coming in through China.
Thank you, Senator. The two main vectors, frankly, for synthetics, especially synthetic opioids, fentanyl, carfentanil, and analogs. So in this massive flood of e-commerce, this tremendous growth of mail shipments coming from China, express consignment coming from China, we are seeing hard narcotics, vials of fentanyl, 25 grams, that we're trying to detect in this flood of packages, and it's very potent. The drug seizures we're making in the mail environment are 90% pure on average, so a very small amount could actually be pressed into pills at a very high level in terms of making profit and producing doses in the U.S. On the Mexican side, we're seeing prepackaged fentanyl doses, often in pill presses, that it's more at the 10% purity level. So it's a much lower level, but it's produced ready to use as opposed to needing further processing in the U.S. I think the bulk of our volume seizures are still on the southwest border for all drugs, but including our synthetic opioids. We do see precursors coming from China and other countries being synthesized by cartels in Mexico and then smuggled across our border in increasing amounts as well. They tend to seek to seize the market share on any new opportunity to smuggle drugs into the U.S. So that's what we've seen in with fentanyl as well.
So what is the cooperation like right now with the Mexican government, since the bulk of the drugs coming in the United States are coming across our southwest border?
So we've established connections with the new leaders of our counterpart agencies, from PGR that does the investigations, to the federal police, which is transitioning into a National Guard status. Right now, they just had a very overwhelming vote in support of transitioning to a National Guard. That's going to be a five-year process. We know what it's like to merge and change as a department. We did that in 2003 extensively. That's a distraction. So that's something that we want to work with our partners to make sure we remain focused on the threats. We've got good relationships with their head of security, Secretary DeRazzo, and we're going to stay focused on this issue and try to maintain our efforts. We have seen targeted takeouts of meth labs based on intelligence and information sharing from U.S. law enforcement, so I think that's a positive sign.
That is a positive sign. Tell me about the effectiveness or non-effectiveness of new fencing. You've replaced some of the fencing in
right.
San Diego and some of that area. You've had enough time to be able to evaluate it. How's it working compared to old fencing?
Yeah, a complete difference. And I'm glad you asked that question, because there's been a lot of reporting that suggests this isn't a new capability. This is just replacement. This isn't helpful. This wasn't important border wall. It couldn't be further from the truth. Those were our top requirements. We had this dilapidated wall. This was the first wall built because it was needed the most in San Diego and in El Centro sector, for instance. Now having a 30-foot wall in El Centro sector where there's a mall within 40 yards of the border has completely changed that dynamic. The traffic has dropped off the table in that area, and we're able to deploy and use our agents more efficiently in other parts of the sector.
So do you have a good idea of side-by-side what the movement of individuals or drugs used to be through that same area, or what it is now with the new fencing?
We do. I can get you that data. The percentage drop has been dramatic.
That'd be great. So we'd like to be able to see that, because obviously there has been a lot of pushback to say this is just replacement, so it makes no difference. The numbers that I've seen on a preliminary basis show a pretty significant difference between that new fencing and between the older fencing that wasn't very effective at all. Let me shift gears a little bit. My state has been like several states that we have had a tremendous amount of water come on us. Right. The flooding in my state has been pretty dramatic and continues to increase, and we have storms predicted the next 4 days in a row again. So this is an area that I'm tracking very, very closely, working with the Corps of Engineers and with others that are there. FEMA's been on the ground. We appreciate FEMA's engagement there, and we'll continue to be able to work with you on that. What do you need at this point that you do not have already for disaster relief, whether that be in my state in Oklahoma, whether it be in Missouri, where there was a tornado last night in Jefferson City, or whether that be in Florida or Puerto Rico or in California?
So I think we have the resources and the support we need to support Oklahoma in this recovery. I talked to the governor 2 weeks ago about the flooding and the potential for increased flooding as rains continue and the river stays very high. We're very worried about it. And what I heard was the partnership between the state and locals and FEMA has been tremendous on this, that they're getting what they need at the state level. But I absolutely want to continue the communication. We'd love to hear from your office if there are opportunities to improve that.
Thank you. We'll continue to walk through that. FEMA's cooperation has been excellent, and we appreciate that continued engagement there. I need to ask you just a couple other quick things. One is on the Coast Guard process. You and I have talked briefly before that as far as interdiction on the water, the Coast Guard process for interdictions and Customs and Border Patrol have two different structures to do interdiction. The Coast Guard process is much longer than Customs and Border Patrol. And I've always wondered within DHS, while we have two entities, both on the water, one has one process, one has another, and the Coast Guard process is a much, much longer process. And I'd like for you just to be able to take a look again and to be able to help our Coast Guard folks able to do a faster interdiction as the Customs and Border Patrol does currently as well. There's also some non-lethal resources that Customs and Border Patrol have when they're on the water that Coast Guard does not have access to, and it'd be helpful to be able to help both those entities on the water to be able to get that level of engagement interdiction faster. Let me shift a little bit to cybersecurity. What DHS did in the 2018 election was pretty remarkable in your engagement in Lean In. A lot of threats, a lot of lessons learned from 2016, very different DHS engagement in 2018. I know you're staying engaged, but I need to ask you about that. How is the engagement for election security, and knowing that every federal agency looks to you to be able to help them with cybersecurity for that entity, how is that going as far as resource-wise?
Yeah, so this is something I've been working on multiple times a week in my 6 weeks as acting, but it's also an area where I have high confidence in Chris Krebs and the leadership of our CISA team. I think they have a great strategy to capitalize on the successes and momentum from 18 for the 2020 election, Protect 2020, we're calling it. They want to get to all 8,800 jurisdictions in the country, not just all 50 states, but all the jurisdictions that are overseeing elections, and make sure that they have the right systems in place, that if they want scanning or penetration testing, we can do that in advance and help them prepare. And really, I think the relationships and the communication is robust. We built a lot of trust from 16 to 18 in our partnerships with state and locals. So I feel very good about the election security strategy. In terms of the interagency on the federal network side, we do have good buy-in on our protections at the edge of the gateway and the Einstein system and others. We do need to continue to work on that. You know, talking with the CISA team, their top three priorities are getting better at what they already do, federal networks, election security, and soft targets. And then, of course, working supply chain issues where we see components being brought into supply chains that could have vulnerabilities, and obviously industrial control systems. That's a huge challenge for cyber, could have the biggest impact, everything from power to pipelines. So we're going to stay on top of it across those areas.
Please do. Kevin, thanks for all your work on this.
Thank you.
Senator Rosen.
Thank you. I want to thank you for bringing this important hearing here today, and I want to thank you for your service for so many years. It's really important, and your knowledge is great, and your compassion as well. And so I want to ask a couple questions on family separation. A couple weeks ago, my colleague, Congressman Carbajal, and I sent a letter about misleading information we received last year when we visited the border. I haven't yet received a response from your department, but maybe you could provide me with some answers. Recent news reports indicate that DHS and HHS officials exchanged emails on June 23rd, 2018, acknowledging that the departments did not have the necessary information to reunite migrant children with their families. And those email exchanges, DHS and HHS admitted, and I'm going to quote here, in short, no, we do not have any linkages from parents to children. We have a list of parent alien numbers, but no way to link them to children, end quote. On that same day, DHS issued a fact sheet claiming the department knew the location of all the children in custody, that the department had a process in place for the families to know the location for the children, and had a central database you could access and update. So just 2 days after that, Congressman Carbajal and I, on June 25th, traveled to the border to Tortornillo, the unaccompanied minor facility. We were falsely told by leadership in those DHS and HHS facilities that the departments had the necessary information to reunite the families. So my question I'm hoping to ask Mr., I guess, Acting Secretary, taking a step back, how could you or how would you explain the discrepancy between the private emails exchanged between the government officials and the fact sheet published to the public the same day?
Thank you for the question, Senator. I'll do my best to explain it here and then make sure that we have an appropriate and robust response to your inquiry. There are five different components involved primarily in dealing with immigration. Three agencies within DHS, Health and Human Services, ORNR, and the Department of Justice, EOIR. All five manage different IT systems. Now, let's just start with that. That's a challenge. Mm-hmm. On April 19th of 2018, CBP, at the request of HHS, implemented an adjustment to its system to be able to capture parent-child relationships more explicitly in our data at the border. Now, that's a CBP system. It's not necessarily available directly to all HHS personnel as of June of 2018. So when you're seeing an email like that, I'm giving you a broad answer.
Right.
I'm not answering what the individuals who are sending that email are thinking or talking to specifically, but my interpretation of that is that having to go to a list of parent alien numbers means that they have to go to a different system. They can't automatically see the linkages between the parent and child and the two different systems. They have.
You think it was a lack of communication interagency?
A lack of system integration interagency. I think the communication was very good, and I want to comment on the reunification in a second. But first, we're going to fix this. It's one of my priorities as Acting Secretary to have a unified immigration portal that allows that data to connect and be integrated across agencies. That's doable. We did it for 47 departments and agencies for trade data when I was the Deputy Commissioner at CBP in the automated commercial environment called the single window. Mm-hmm. We can improve this process and certainly help ensure relationships are captured between people arriving at the border. So that's a priority. The reason I know that I can say with confidence that the data was captured and the intent of what was said publicly about our systems was borne out is the reunifications actually happened pretty rapidly. And the reunifications were broadly successful by HHS working with ICE and CBP data.
So let me follow up on that. Of the children that are still separated from their families, and we know there are still quite a few, how many, in your estimation, how many cases still lack the information necessary for reunification? And could you provide that information to us?
So that's being provided by Health and Human Services in, I think, biweekly filings to the Miss L Court, the exact status of that. And I would refer you for an official answer to that data and to HHS. My understanding is that every single child has an identified parent relationship at this point.
Okay, we'll refer out to that. And I have another couple things. In my estimation, of course, your department has a lot of work to do to regain the public trust, including mine. And so as you lead the department forward, will you personally commit to all of us to truthfully respond to the committee that your department won't mislead us again in the way we were misled last year when I visited the border, no matter what the severity of issues are at hand?
So law enforcement depends on public trust. It is a fundamental requirement to carry out our mission and carry out our jobs. I will ensure that as long as I'm acting, we're going to do our level best to explain what's happening to Congress, to the American people, on all aspects of our mission.
Thank you. I have one last question quickly on family separation and the training that you're providing for the DHS officers to determine or not whether families are falling into the criteria of needing to be separated, what you're going to do going forward. You said you have a lack of bed space, lack of detention space. What are your plans going forward to train your officers to take care with these families when they're going through this?
So thank you for the question. And so this a case where a child and a parent are separated now is extraordinarily rare. It's done for the safety of the child. If there's a serious criminal violation, any indication that the parent presents a risk to that child, if there's a communicable disease issue for either the parent or the child, they need to go to emergency care. It's happening 1 to 3 times a day out of up to 3,000 families arriving. So I just want to be very clear, it's a very rare situation, and it's got defined criteria that we've, by policy, mandated for our personnel in the field in accordance with the Ms. L court order and the President's executive order from June 20th of last year. So it's extraordinarily rare. In terms of the process for doing that, I think there's an opportunity with our Civil Rights and Civil Liberties Office to look across our department and see if we can ensure that we're doing it consistently for CBP or ICE, for instance, and that we're taking all steps to consider the care of the child, the mental concerns a child might have in that scenario, and explain it effectively. So I think there's an opportunity there I'd like to work on.
Thank you.
Senator Sinema.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our nation faces a crisis along the southern border, and I'm working with local leaders in Arizona, my colleagues in Congress, and the administration to stop the flow of migrants to the southern border and ensure the fair and humane treatment of migrants who do come. The situation on the ground with our communities, NGOs, and our border workforce is not sustainable. So we must work together to find bipartisan and common sense solutions. Acting Secretary, I'm glad you're here today, and I look forward to our discussion. The lack of transportation resources to manage the flow of migrants is a serious problem in Arizona. We need help transporting migrants between interception, detention facilities, and ICE, and getting migrants to NGOs to facilitate further transportation. Could you review DHS's capability to provide additional transportation resources in Arizona, including resources from outside CBP or ICE, and get back to me on what the possibilities are?
I can do that.
Great. This is going well, Chairman. When searching for solutions to a crisis, it's always important to think outside the box. And I hope that you're encouraging your organization to tackle the challenges with the migrant crisis in this manner. I think the transportation issue calls for some outside-the-box thinking. It's in DHS's best interest to work with the NGO groups on how best to manage migrant transportation after they leave DHS custody. But I've heard from some constituents about ideas such as working with sponsors to fund charter bus routes to ease the pressure on crowded Greyhound routes. Such ideas have merit, but will probably need DHS assistance and cooperation to be effective. Could you also take a creative look at what other support DHS could provide to these NGOs on the transportation front and work with us on the ground in Arizona on those possibilities?
Yeah, we'll do that, Senator. I think innovation and partnership are going to be critical as we're managing this crisis. They have been to date with state and local authorities in Arizona and elsewhere. I'll just highlight one quick example of that innovation and creativity. Our acting commissioner, John Sanders at CBP, has been instrumental in bringing together faith-based organizations and NGOs with resources away from the border that want to or are able to help the NGOs at the border that are doing so much work in your state, mm-hmm. in El Paso, in South Texas with Sister Norma Pimentel's organization. And really that's brought in lots of additional resources and funding that's supporting the border entities. So I think we can do the same kind of thing on transportation, not only engaging our Greyhound partners to increase routes, but also look at other creative solutions. In addition to applying the funding we're getting from Congress, we're buying buses for CBP, we're borrowing CDL drivers from the Department of Defense, and we've asked for more transportation funding in the supplemental.
Great. I believe we need to treat all migrants who come to our country fairly and humanely. We also need to determine who's eligible for asylum and who comes to our country as an economic migrant. And the key part of that effort, of course, is the determination of credible fear. Do you feel that the department has sufficient authority to allow immigration and asylum officers to ask enough questions of migrants to get at the truth of any credible fear claims?
I think there's two elements to that. Resource is part of it, right? Being able to take the time at the front end to assess the situation. And we're seeing that, unfortunately, with family units right now. The volume is so high, our Border Patrol agents are not able to spend adequate time with each family to do their interviews to assess the family relationship or if there's any concerns of smuggling or trafficking. And I know that because we've deployed HSI agents from ICE to both El Paso and RGV over the last 3 weeks. Out of 560 interviews, they found 160 cases of fraud. Granted, these were targeted cases based on risk, based on visuals and prior interviews by Border Patrol, but that's an incredibly high percentage. And they're prosecuting the adults involved, but I'm very worried that resource-wise, we don't have enough, to your point, to detect that fraud and protect the safety of children that could be trafficked or smuggled by adults right now, given the flood of the crush. The other aspect of credible fear, though, is the standard. There's clearly too big a gap between the front-end bar on credible fear, a possibility of proving an asylum case, and the ultimate determination by a judge. To have 85 to 90% pass that first bar, but only 10 to 15% pass the asylum bar, with a 2 to 5 year gap between those two findings, that's obviously a gap in the framework that's allowing and inciting additional traffic to our border. So I think we need to address not only the resources side, but the standard.
What would you suggest that we that Congress do to help close that gap between the initial interview and the determination in front of a judge?
Well, we've provided language to the Judiciary Committee in the Senate that would apply a different standard on the front end of the credible fear that we think would still allow valid asylum cases to go forward, but reduce that huge gap between the credible fear findings and the asylum findings.
Do you believe that you have the current authority to expand the questions asked at the beginning when folks are intercepted to create a, for lack of a better term, stronger record or longer record to help prepare for litigation? Is that something you have the current authority to do, or do you need Congress's action to ask more questions?
We do have the authority, and we're actually implementing a more standardized approach to those initial questions. My concern is the resources right now,
right,
and the ability for agents to spend the time they need to do that questioning effectively.
So if you had sufficient resources and person power, you could ask more questions at the front end that would help better prepare a case for presentation in front of a judge to either make the claim or to show that there is not evidence for adequate asylum status.
Right, or presentation to an asylum officer as well.
Great. CBP has indicated that it's reassigned over 700 officers from ports of entry and airports around the nation, including some from the Tucson area in Arizona. We also know that there's an effort to transfer TSA officers from airports to assist the Border Patrol. I have some concerns about these decisions and their impact on security. Could you tell me a little bit more about where officers were reassigned from and to so we can better understand the strategy that you're using to move officers?
Sure. So I was commissioner at CBP when we started the deployment of CBP officers to support our Border Patrol agents, and it was simply to increase our ability to safely care for families and children in our custody. And that was the more immediate need than addressing wait times of commercial traffic, for instance, which is critical to our commerce, as you know well. Mm-hmm. The Nogales-Mariposa Port of Entry is one of the most important arteries for trade with Mexico across the whole border. But we had a more important and acute need to take care of children. So that's how we made that determination. We have now balanced the sourcing of our CBP officers to include northern border locations, airports and seaports from around the country, and not just our southern border field offices. So that's the strategy we're applying there. And certainly we're eager to get those officers back doing their primary mission if we can help mitigate this crisis. In terms of TSA or other components of DHS that we've asked to surge, volunteers to help at the border, this is what we do in a crisis. This is what we do in a response to a natural disaster, for instance. Very clearly, we are not going to allow an increase of risk in our aviation security system. Not going to allow that. We don't even have any TSOs deployed at this time as volunteers. We have our federal air marshals who are part of Viper teams who are mobile to begin with. that are helping on the border, and we're taking office management staff and other capabilities as volunteers. We're looking for attorneys, we're looking for CDL drivers, but not TSOs yet. TSOs might be required in the future, but again, we had 2,000 people deployed as volunteers for Harvey. We only have 250 or so right now for this crisis. So it's going to be managed carefully. We're not going to increase risk in other mission areas, but we might increase wait times here or there. And we've had that effect at the ports of entry on the border, and that is a concern.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Sinema. So, Mr. McAleenan, you've done a terrific job, in my view, of answering questions and showing your vast amount of experience in this area, and we need you right now. And so we thank you for being here. We understand you're willing to stay till 11:10. We've had the first round for everybody. We're going to have a second round. It'll be a lightning round. We're going to try 4 minutes here. And I appreciate the fact that my colleague, Senator Peters, has allowed Senator Lankford and me to go, and also Senator Hastin, thank you, because we have to leave just before 11. And so if you're willing to stay, we'll be able to get to everybody's second round. Thank you, Senator Rosen. Senator Lankford.
Kevin, thanks again for the work. I need to also thank you for the new advisory committee that you put in place for houses of worship. After the attacks in Pittsburgh, after the attacks in Texas, after the attacks that we've seen in multiple places, that's a very helpful thing. So thanks for engaging. Is there anything in particular we need to know about that, that we can help and assist in what your work is?
So we're very concerned about the increased attacks on houses of worship of all faiths, both here in the U.S. and globally. What the recommendation, frankly, of the Committee on Homeland Security, Chairman Thompson and Ranking Member Rogers, I looked at it, talked with our team, and we've asked the Homeland Security Advisory Council, who's provided just outstanding advice. This is a bipartisan group of experts, former leaders, state and local leaders, and they've given us great advice across all kinds of missions.
Right.
And I think asking them to take on this challenge and look at how we engage faith-based organizations, houses of worship, on their security, on their preparedness, on concerns in their communities, regardless of the motivation or ideology behind the violence, we want to get in front of that and prevent it, and obviously partner with the FBI to address it if it does occur. So I'm looking forward to their recommendations. They took on the task. Judge Webster, a hero of the United States, is still working to help secure the country well into his 90s. Received the task, and they're going to follow up on it aggressively. Perfect. So thank you.
No, thank you for stepping up. That's a great need, whether it's in Charlotte or Pittsburgh or California or Texas. We've seen violence in houses of worship, and to be able to have some attention there is exceptionally helpful. I want to bring up a conversation you and I can have at a later time about the use of E-Verify and also I-9. For employers that use E-Verify, they also have to use I-9. They're really using two different systems. They're going two different directions. It's redundant paperwork. We've got to figure out a way to be able to have our systems have one set, whether it's I-9 or E-Verify, but one way to be able to do this for the sake of our employers, to be able to verify legal status. I do need to ask, because you and I have talked before about what I think the term was is recycled children coming across the border, the same child coming across claiming multiple families. Are you still seeing that area, or are you still seeing adults that are claiming to be a child at 17, but they're really 19, 20, 21, and how's that going in determination?
Yeah, we're seeing both. The having the same child smuggled twice by different adults is not as prevalent yet, but we've identified three significant cases where this was an intentional strategy, bringing children in, then flying them back to Central America and having another adult take them to the border and fake a family relationship. So that's unacceptable. We obviously see juveniles, we see 20-year-olds and well into their 20s pretending to be juveniles. We've got 3,500 cases of fraud, either in family relationship or an adult claiming unaccompanied child status so far this year. What we're determining, though, with this HSI deployment is that the problem might be bigger than we thought it was, based on the initial findings from their 3 weeks on the ground. We also have a rapid DNA pilot that's ongoing help us determine family relationships. On the first day of that pilot, we had 12 adults come forward and say, it's not my child.
Wow.
First day of the pilot in one location. So that's a major concern, and so we need to expand our capability to identify those relationships, to attack the fraud, and then the technology support for our agents and officers to do that.
And find out whose child that is that's just been smuggled and,
right,
and moved. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Lankford. You all just talked for a moment about this issue of attacks on houses of worship, and I wanted to follow up with you on that if I could. In the wake of the terrible tragedies in Pittsburgh, San Diego, with regard to the synagogues and houses of worship in places like Texas and Charleston, you at DHS have been supportive of what's called the Nonprofit Security Grant Program. However, it's not authorized. We do it as a carve-out in the appropriations bill. This is funding that goes not just for the advice and expertise, and I appreciate the fact that the advisory committee is now getting going because we need to provide best practices to these groups, but also provides grant funding to be able to ensure that you have safer facilities, whether it's a synagogue or a church, a community center, a school. Unfortunately, it's needed. So Senator Peters and I, who's here with me today, have just introduced legislation. It's $75 million a year authorization. The Nonprofit Security Grant Program, again, is something that has been supported but not authorized. One, we'd love you to support that legislation so that we can have some certainty going forward and begin to really build this program to the point that it can provide better protection. But second, in terms of where the money goes, there's a GAO report that just came out recently that said that your risk assessment you're using doesn't take into account all the diverse threats that are out there today. So two questions. One, would you support our authorization legislation? And second, based on this recent GAO report, are you reevaluating the risk assessment formula to take account of these diverse threats?
Thanks for the question, Senator. First of all, I'll look at this, the nonprofit grants and the authorizing language. I'd be happy to look at that with you and get back to you shortly. That is something I would like the Homeland Security Advisory Council to advise us on, is what support do we need to provide as a federal government in this sector going forward? So I'd be happy to work with you on that. In terms of the risk assessment, I'm not familiar with that GAO recommendation, but I know our departmental processes to assess and respond to the GAO recommendations are extensive, and we'll certainly take that on.
This was a 2018 report, so I think it now is probably something that your folks have taken a look at and analyzed. So if you could get back to us in the next couple of weeks with your response, that would be terrific. Again, sadly, we have this continued threat out there, and we need to do more. With regard to fentanyl, we talked earlier about what's going on in the border, the crystal meth coming over, affecting my state of Ohio and so many other states, as well as cocaine, heroin. Some of the fentanyl goes from Mexico as well. Most of it's coming from China. But the major threat we still face in this country is directly from China coming into the United States through our own U.S. mail system. That's why we passed the STOP Act here last year in Congress. We're now trying to implement it. The post office is behind. You know, they were supposed to have 100% of packages coming from China be able to be screened by having this advanced electronic data. Unfortunately, it's only 76% as of January. They're supposed to meet a target of 70% of all packages from around the world. Unfortunately, they were only at 57%. This affects you directly because your Customs and Border Protection people don't have the ability to be able to get the information and screen these packages, pull off the vulnerable packages without this advanced electronic data. So my question to you today is, what are you doing to ensure compliance with the STOP Act? Are you coordinating with the Postal Service to try to get these percentages up to the requirement under the STOP Act? And what more can we do to ensure that all aspects of this law are being complied with?
Sure. Thank you, Senator, and thank you for your ongoing support of DHS in this area and really holding us and the Postal Service accountable for getting better in the mail environment. I think that's critical. 76% is not where we need to be for China, given the threat. It was less than 10% 2 years ago, and I do think the support and pressure from the STOP Act and others have helped us get better with the Postal Service. I can tell you this is a priority diplomatically all the way up to the presidential level, engaging personally with President Xi on this issue. Our ambassador, State Department are all engaged on China taking harsher measures on illicit fentanyl production and shipment out of China. That's going to continue to be a diplomatic priority and one that I certainly favor from a DHS perspective. I do want to just point out, though, that we've gotten a lot better with that 76%. We are getting more and more seizures that have been targeted based on information. and were able to work with the Postal Inspection Service and HSI to go and take down that pill press domestically. We've had a half a dozen cases of significance in that regard just in the last 6 months. It's something I want to make sure we get better at, and we're going to keep pressing. I can tell you the Postmaster General, Margaret Benton, who I've met with a dozen times in the last year, is very focused on this mission and working hard to try to increase those percentages, but we've got to get better.
I appreciate your personal commitment to it and your meetings with me over the years, really, and meeting with her as well. And I just want you to keep the pressure on them, because this is still the deadliest substance affecting us, killing more people than any other drug.
No question.
Senator Peters.
Thank you, Mr. Mr. McAleenan, recent news articles and litigation have highlighted the issue of government watch lists, especially in relation to intrusive and lengthy secondary screenings when traveling. Michigan, as you know, has a very rich history of welcoming diverse communities from around the world, and they're an integral part of the life of our state. But unfortunately, many are also frequently subject to disruptions, which sometimes can last an hour or more whenever they travel. So my question to you, sir, is the department studying ways to streamline screenings, especially for American citizens who are forced to undergo long secondary screenings?
We are, and I can tell you, and I'm familiar with some of the issues with routine border crossings in Detroit, for instance, in your state. The watch list serves a very important purpose for identifying risk, and a border crossing event is an important opportunity to see if there's a security threat. When that becomes routine, when that becomes an issue with a daily crosser who's a U.S. citizen, even if there's valid security concerns, that's something we generally would modify. So after an appropriate number of inspections, appropriate coordination with any investigative agency, we will reduce or not have that watch list record fire on primary. So we are changing that. It's something we monitor carefully. The other challenge we have is very similar names, date of birth issues. So somebody having a secondary examination who's not actually the subject of the watch list record, we've put in place a primary lookout override function that allows us to not hit on that other traveler the next time. So that's something that we can always put in place. An individual has concerns, should ask for a supervisor, express those concerns, and we can address them.
What is the department doing to ensure that the staff is conducting secondary screenings that are sensitive to many of the cultural as well as religious considerations of folks who are being screened?
Right. We spend a lot of time on the training, and our policies are very clear on this. There's no room for bias or discrimination in our secondary procedures, in our approaches to interviewing those who are crossing our border. If there are concerns, we want to hear a complaint that we can follow up on at the supervisory level or with our Office of Professional Responsibility if it's a misconduct issue. For all of our personnel that are involved in counterterrorism response and expertise, we call them our tactical terrorism response teams at ports of entry, they go through a higher level of training that involves sensitivity issues with questioning with certain populations and religious concerns as well. So that's a commitment I have. I helped design that training at way back in the Office of Anti-Terrorism era when I was the first director at U.S. Customs Service and then CBP. It's a commitment that we've improved over the years, and I do think we're doing that quite well. It's something we've partnered with the Civil Rights and Civil Liberties Office on, and I commit to ensuring that we continue that effort.
Well, I appreciate that commitment, and we've spoken about this issue several times, and as you know, I'm still hearing an awful lot of complaints, lots of concerns, so I would certainly hope that we can continue to work together to find out exactly what where those gaps are and how we can fill those gaps, so I appreciate your commitment.
If I could just add, Senator, if you could get individual permission from your constituents to share those complaints, we're able to follow up and identify if there's a challenge or a pattern or training opportunity.
Great. Then we will do that. I want to build my last question here on Senator Portman's questions relating to attacks on houses of worship and the work that I'm doing with him on a grant program. But my question is, on May 8th, Chairman Johnson and I sent you, FBI Director Wray, and Attorney General Barr a request for information about your department's use of federal resources to detect and to prevent domestic terrorism. We wrote you during a time of some disturbing increases in white supremacist violence, including the murder of white nationalists and neo-Nazis in Charlottesville, the Tree of Life Synagogue attack in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston, Oak Creek, Wisconsin, and many, many more attacks that I know you're very well aware of. Are you concerned about this rise of white supremacist violence, and does the DHS have the flexibility in your authorities to respond to this evolving threat?
So first, very concerned about it. And this is going to be a priority of our Targeted Violence and Terrorist Prevention Office, which we've just created and broadened their mandate in the last 6 weeks at DHS. White supremacist extremist violence is a huge issue and one that we need a whole of community effort for. I mean, it's been the ideology that's motivated a number of those faith-based attacks that we've been talking about and are going to be a focus of our Homeland Security Advisory Council review. For DHS, our mission is prevention on this front, intelligence sharing with state and locals, and then support to Joint Terrorism Task Force investigations by the FBI. FBI is obviously the lead investigative component, but we're going to maintain that commitment. Threats evolve. This is an evolving and an increasingly concerning threat.
Well, we requested a response by yesterday from your office. I understand this morning we've received some information, but I need your commitment that we'll have your full cooperation as both Chairman and Johnson and I look at this issue. So I appreciate that. Do I have your commitment?
You do.
With that, Senator Hassan.
Well, thank you, Ranking Member Peters. And again, Mr. Acting Secretary, thank you for spending a long morning with us.
We
appreciate it very much. I want to follow up. I have two questions. They're both follow-ups, really, in a way, to others. Senator Portman talked about our ongoing battle about opioids generally, but fentanyl in particular. Last Congress we passed and the President signed into law the Interdict Act, which provides more technology for border agents to detect fentanyl at the border. When I was at the border last year, I heard that agents still didn't have access to this equipment. Former Secretary Nielsen stated that it was unacceptable when she testified before this committee last May. Can you provide an update to the committee on the status of implementing the Interdict Act?
So I believe we've implemented the Interdict Act at the highest traffic locations for concerns for fentanyl or synthetic opioids, and we've dramatically increased our testing capability across the board. That doesn't mean we have it everywhere we need it or in every port of entry. The investments in FY19, which we're currently procuring and deploying, will help augment that. But absolutely, we'll look at our laydown and make sure it's comprehensive and supports this critical mission area.
So are all the FY19 then funds, have they been spent?
Not yet.
Not yet.
They're currently in the planning and deployment phase.
And are all the machines that you have operational at this time?
Any new machines that were purchased under the Interdict Act, unless there's a maintenance issue, yes, they're operational.
Okay. What still needs to be done? Just expanding them to other sites?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, no, we deploy on a risk-based, prioritized basis. So that'll be the mail facilities, express consignment, the major Southwest border ports of entry, and then we try to get to the rest of the key areas.
Okay. And so do you have the funding that you need to do that?
I believe so. I'll report back to you if we're missing resources.
All right. Please do. We'd love to stay up to date on that with you. I also wanted to follow up on the issue of domestic terrorism. I greatly appreciate the attention of DHS and my colleagues on fighting domestic terrorism against houses of worship and faith-based groups. As Senator Peters just mentioned, like him, Senator Grassley and I have also sent your agency a letter expressing concern over the rise of domestic terrorism and requesting more information on what DHS is doing to prevent and mitigate this threat to ensure public safety. I want to ask you just a series of questions to get a better sense of the resources that the department has dedicated to combating domestic terrorism. And since we've got limited time, let's see if we can do a lightning round. I take it that you agree that domestic non-foreign terrorist organization-inspired terrorism is on the rise, as stated in this administration's National Strategy for Counterterrorism?
Yes.
Given the emphasis of domestic terrorism in this national strategy, does DHS have a 2019 strategy specifically addressing the rise in domestic terrorism threats?
So we're working on a formal strategy, but we do have that as a priority operational effort already.
And as you work on that formal strategy, once you get it done, I take it you will share it with the committee?
Yes.
On a related note, what percentage of the department's budget is specifically dedicated to addressing domestic terrorism, and how does that amount compare to previous years?
I don't have that information here, but we can get back to you on that.
Do you know how many, and thank you, I would love it if you'd get back to us on that. How many intelligence analysts at DHS headquarters tasked with the primary responsibility of covering domestic terrorism are there?
I'll get back to you on that as well, but what I can tell you is that under Undersecretary Glawi, he's forward deployed a number of the intel analysts to work directly embedded with state and locals around the country, not only in our fusion centers, but in key sheriffs and police departments around the country, and that's one of their focus areas.
And I'll ask a similar update about how many policy and program staff you have exclusively focusing on domestic terrorism.
Okay.
I shared the concern that it is on the rise here. I have been concerned that resources that once were devoted to domestic terrorism have been taken and used other places. And it's one thing to say we care about it and are committed to it, which I believe, and I understand. It's another thing to have the resources, personnel, focused to do it. So I'll look forward to that update from you, and thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Hassan. We have 3 minutes remaining in the hearing. Senator Rosen, they are yours.
All right. Well, let's see how fast I can talk. You know, I want to talk about TPS just a tiny bit. So there have been serious allegations of improper political interference in the decision-making process surrounding the termination of TPS for people from El Salvador, Nicaragua, and several other countries. Thousands of them live in Nevada. So, as you know, Immigration and Nationality Act provides for TPS status in cases where Secretary of DHS finds that civil unrest, violence, natural disasters, or any other temporary conditions preventing foreign nationals from returning safely home to their countries or where their home countries can't absorb them. A federal judge has recently written in deciding to terminate TPS status of Haiti, El Salvador, Nicaragua, and Sudan, they changed the criteria applied by the prior administrations and did so without any explanation or justification in violation of the Administrative Procedure Act. So I'm going to go quickly. I have two questions. I know that these decisions are currently the subject of litigation, but since you've taken over the department, have you looked into the decision-making process for TPS status determination, and will you commit to cooperating with the Inspector General with that investigation, looking into improper political influence and decision-making process for changing this criteria?
So understanding the importance of TPS decision-making, I have in my first 6 weeks asked when our next decision is coming up, but I've been informed about the ongoing litigation, and it's something we'll do carefully, applying the standards appropriately, if and when the next TPS decision is presented.
Okay, thousands of people in my state are depending on a fair decision on this, so I look forward to working with you. Thank you for staying extra.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you, Acting Secretary Michelina. We appreciate you being here today. We appreciate your testimony, and I'll look forward to working with you in the months and years ahead. The hearing record will remain open for 15 days until June 7th at 5 p.m. for the submission of statements and questions for the record. And with that, the hearing is adjourned.
Thanks for your testimony today. I appreciate it.
Thank you.